Welcome to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility, an ongoing inquiry into American political origins and evolving institutions. The Executive Director of the Virtual Center is Dr. Bill Obrien. He's also your host for this continuing conversation. Here he is now, Dr. Bill Obrien.
Well, thank you, Agnes, and welcome to today's edition of the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. We're into the second day of a new year. Today is January 2nd in the year 2018. It is a pleasure to be with you again for a live program. As most of you who listen regularly know, today is our last program this week, and our next scheduled program is next Monday. So have a number of items and issues that I'd like to touch on today. This is one of those this, that, and the other days that I'm not really sure where it's going. I felt a little bit more comfortable yesterday than I do today because I knew that we had an issue yesterday that the survey for the constitutional amendment on term limits that the conservative caucus put out. I knew that that would not only take some time in our program, but was also a significant political issue, it seems to me, because we've been wondering, and I think the media has been speculating on what divided government is going to be like under President Trump now that the Democrats, as of tomorrow noon, take control of the House of Representatives. And that there's been a lot of speculation about whether they'll be able to work together or whether it'll be just a totally divided government, dysfunctional Congress again, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And in fact, I noticed this morning that the president put out word that he really believes that he can accomplish some important things with the Democrats in control of the House, and he can work with them and all this. And as many of you know, the president has called leaders of both parties into the White House tomorrow for a conference on border security, and obviously this also relates to the issue of the ongoing shutdown, which is in its 12th day now. I think the survey that we looked at yesterday and the ambitious goal of 10 million responses on term limits for members of Congress, I think that pretty much is a sign as to what a political strategy coming from the White House is going to look like. I think, and it's pretty obvious to me, that the president was more than willing to continue to go along as long as the Congress went along with him while Paul Ryan was Speaker. And, of course, Mitch McConnell is still the leader in the Senate. And they were going along pretty much with everything. And as far as the president was concerned, it seemed that Congress was fine. But now that the Democrats have taken over, now the issue of term limits has reared its head. And as I mentioned yesterday, I think we do have to look forward to 2020 as well, because there really is a possibility – I'm not going to say probability, but possibility – that the Democrats could take not only the House as they did in this midterm election in 2016 in 2018 rather, but also in 2020 could take the Senate. Because numbers of Senate seats that are up for re-election in 2020 include a number currently being held by Republicans. That was not the case in this midterm election in 2018. Most of the Senate seats being contested in the election were held by Democrats. So what that meant was that it would be almost impossible for the Democrats to take control of the Senate this time around. And in fact, the projections were that actually the Democrats could lose a few Senate seats, and indeed they did. But that is going to be a different ballgame in 2020. So I think this certificate or this petition, and the search for 10 million responses, it seems to me is an indication of where the conservative right hopes to go with the with divided government in the offing for 2019 and 2020. Welcome to today's program on the Virtual Center. It's a pleasure to be with you. I want to thank you for your continued support of the program and of Bob Kincaid and Agnes and the folks at Head On as well. It's that network that enables us to bring this program to you three times a week, as we have done now for the better part of 6 years. We'll be entering our seventh year in March. But I do encourage you to take advantage of the opportunities available for interaction by coming on the air with us and sharing your thoughts and concerns with us. I think our listeners would appreciate it as well. I'm sure they get tired of just listening to me day after day and would love to hear thoughts from a different source. I've gotten some very positive response to the program we did 2 weeks ago today with Kevin Shanley on China. In fact, I want to make mention of a couple of things related to China in a moment. And I think as much as anything else, it was the fact that it was a totally different experience. And I think that people enjoyed it. And we do have two numbers available, and either one of these numbers will get you into the studios and thereby directly on the air. Both numbers have the same area code 304. The first number is 304-574-8178. That's 304-574-8178. The second number, same area code, 304-640-2829. 304-640-2829. If you're not really interested in calling in and coming on the air live, then you might want to share your thoughts with me either in an email or by using our Facebook page. Either one will work. If you'd like to send me an email and include your thoughts or your concerns and trust me to get your thoughts or ideas on the air for you, I'd be glad to do that. My email address is waobrien906@gmail.com. That's waobrien, O-B-R-I-E-N, 906@gmail.com. Or you can go to our Facebook page. Just go to facebook.com, the homepage, and in the search box at the top, type in the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution, and you'll be on to our Facebook page. And on that page, you'll see a number of postings. And at the end of each posting, there are two links, a share link and a comment link. If you click on the share link, that particular posting is distributed to all your friends on Facebook. And of course, that gives us wider coverage, and we obviously appreciate that. If you click on the comment link, it gives you an opportunity to comment directly back to me. Presumably, your comment would be related to that particular posting, but that it doesn't necessarily have to be that way. I get notice on my Facebook account that there has been a comment to a particular posting, and my Facebook account immediately takes me to the posting along with your comment. And so I get almost, immediate notice when you comment on a particular posting, and or you can just comment on anything else related to the program. The point is, we would love to hear from you, and all of these mechanisms are ways that we feel makes it easier for you to interact with me and with the program and gives us an opportunity to respond more directly to your concerns and the issues which which bother you most or issues which you are most concerned with. So with that daily housekeeping out of the way, let's touch on a number of issues. That, as I mentioned yesterday, there are a number of issues. I think tomorrow we have the new Democratic majority taking over in the House of Representatives. That I noticed that C-SPAN is going to bring us live coverage of the opening of the Congress tomorrow and the swearing in of the new members and of both House and Senate. So that's something to look forward to tomorrow. Also tomorrow, the president has called the leaders, Democratic and Republican leaders, into the White House for a meeting on the issue of border security. And of course, that gets us into the whole issue of the wall. I think we're going to see what I think is a very interesting mention of the idea of a wall long before President Trump came up with the gimmick, so to speak. So you know, again, there are a number of issues going on tomorrow. One of the things that that I meant to comment on yesterday and neglected to do it was the resignation of James Mattis. And if you remember, this happened during the holiday period and over the holidays. And we weren't doing a live program, so we couldn't comment upon it then. But the fact of the matter is, many of you know that James Mattis resigned. And his resignation letter was submitted to the president well over a week ago. And according to the letter, Mattis was going to stay in on the job until the end of February, until the 28th of February. And when the president received the resignation letter, he immediately took it to the public and thanked James Mattis for his 2 years of service to the administration and talked about what a wonderful job. And President Trump was very positive and very cordial to James Mattis. And the thinking was that it wasn't really a surprise, that everybody expected that Mattis would be leaving office. Well, the fact of the matter is, and I know many of you have done this, if you read Mattis's letter of resignation, it becomes very clear that Mattis, in his resignation letter, really takes President Trump and Trump's policies, international policies, to task. Mattis's letter of resignation is very critical of President Trump. But the fact of the matter is, you have to really read and digest the letter in order to see this. Because Mattis writes the letter, crafts the letter in such a way that he addresses his priorities, his own priorities in international affairs, and then drops the bomb, which is, with my resignation, I trust that the president will be able to find somebody to replace me whose views on international affairs more closely correspond with his own. So the message there in that letter is that Mattis lays out his view of the international arena and what the United States ought to be doing with allies and the threat of nationalism and the importance of partnerships and you know, of global cooperation and free trade and open trade and international trade, all of these things. And then basically criticizes the president by suggesting that these are my positions, but they aren't the president's. So with my leaving office, that's going to give him an opportunity to bring somebody in whose views coincide with his own more closely. The fact of the matter is, President Trump had Mattis's letter of resignation for 2 days before he began criticizing and attacking Mattis. And there are some people who have suspected that the president didn't read the letter. Because if he read the letter, he would have realized that the letter was extremely critical of him. And the fact that he was so cordial to Mattis and not angry at all suggested to many people that A, the president didn't read the letter, or B, if he read it, he really didn't understand it. He didn't read it that carefully. Or in fact, as a few people have suggested, maybe he couldn't read it that carefully. I saw one criticism of President Trump, which I thought was interesting. It was referring to the idea of encryption, as you know, in the computer world. You can encrypt your messages so that nobody can get them without a code. Well, this particular criticism of President Trump suggested that Mattis's message to President Trump was a little bit difficult to get at because the message was encrypted in complete sentences, the implication being that President Trump can't really read all that well. His comprehension is limited. Whatever the reason, it's very clear that initially the president didn't really know what was in Mattis's letter until the media began to jump all over Mattis's letter and point out the ways that Mattis was criticizing President Trump and President Trump's behavior on the international scene. And it's only then when the media began to point out Mattis's criticism that Donald Trump turned on Mattis and suddenly demanded that his end of service be immediate, that he not stay in on the job until the end of February, but that he get out now. So Mattis effectively is now gone. I think it's very interesting because in the Washington Post, dated yesterday, dated January 1st, but printed today, is a letter from incoming Utah Senator Mitt Romney, former presidential candidate Mitt Romney, which is a major criticism of President Trump. So the significance of this is, of course, that Romney is coming into the United States Senate as of Thursday, openly critical of President Trump, even though he's a Republican. And in this letter, which appeared in today's Washington Post, and I have a copy of the letter here, I'm not going to read the entire letter, but Romney says right at the very beginning of the letter, the Trump presidency made a deep descent in December. The departures of Defense Secretary Jim Mattis and White House Chief of Staff John Kelly, the appointment of senior persons of lesser experience, the abandonment of allies who fight beside us, and the president's thoughtless claim that America has long been a sucker in world affairs, all defined his presidency down. And then Romney lists the initial appointments. He said he acknowledges that during the campaign in 2016, Donald Trump was not my choice for the Republican presidential nomination. After he became the nominee, Romney said, I hoped that his campaign would change, that the negativism of his campaign with the resentment and the name-calling would change. I hoped that with his election, Donald Trump would rise to the office. And then he lists the appointments, the initial appointments that President Trump made when he took office. And one of the things that struck me as I read this is when you read all of these names together and you realize that now they're all gone, you begin to get a sense of how much change there has been in the White House during the 2 years that President Trump has been in office. Romney points out that Donald Trump's earliest appointments of Rex Tillerson, Jeff Sessions, Nikki Haley, Gary Cohn, H.R. McMaster, John Kelly, and Jim Mattis were encouraging. But the fact of the matter is, over the last 2 years, they're all gone. The only one that left on a positive note is Nikki Haley. Tillerson's gone, and the president has attacked him. Jeff Sessions is now gone as attorney general, and the president continues to attack him. Gary Cohn, General McMaster, Kelly, Mattis, now they're all gone, replaced by what Romney calls lesser lights. And the result is that Romney points out that we look to the president to lead the country and pull it together. And that's exactly what isn't happening. There's a piece of information, data in Romney's letter that I wanted to share with you. I thought it was particularly astounding. In 2016, the Pew Research Center conducted a poll, and the results of that poll were that 84% of the people in Germany, Britain, France, Canada, and Sweden believed that the American president would do the right thing in world affairs. That was in 2016. The very next year, in 2017, that 84% positive feeling of the people in these major, these nations, which are our closest allies, the 84% positive result had declined to 16%. So obviously, the people who live in countries that have been traditionally our closest allies, Germany, Britain, France, Canada, Sweden, are incredibly disappointed in President Trump's performance on the international scene. And Romney points out the world needs American leadership. And he argues for the reassuming of our leadership in world affairs and what we need to do in order to make that come about. And then he talks about the fact that he's going in as a Republican, but he commits to the idea that he is not going to suffer in silence. He said, "I will act as I would with any president, in or out of my own party. I will support policies that I believe are in the best interests of the country and my state, and I will oppose those that are not. I do not intend to comment on every tweet or fault, but I will speak out against significant statements or actions that are divisive, racist, sexist, anti-immigrant, dishonest, or destructive to democratic institutions." So what Romney is committing to as an incoming member of the United States Senate is behavior which has been woefully missing from Republicans in the United States Senate, and that is the willingness to speak up against President Trump. What we've seen over the last year is that those few Republican senators who did speak up to President Trump have all left, have not run for reelection. I'm thinking of Jeff Flake and Bob Corker and a number of others. In other words, the people that the Republican senators who've been most critical of the president are those who are leaving the Senate. And what we've not seen are Republicans who continue to sit in the Senate and yet are willing to speak up when the president does something that they don't approve of. Mitt Romney, in this particular op-ed piece in today's Washington Post, commits to changing that scenario. And he does commit to speaking up. So I think that's very significant. I also, again, I can't get away from Mattis's letter and the fact that the president had that letter for in his hands for better than 2 days before he began to criticize Mattis for criticizing him. And the question you have to ask yourself is, did he not read it, or did he not understand it, even if he did read it? I don't know. But the fact of the matter is, he's been incredibly, incredibly caustic toward Jim Mattis once the media began to point out how strong the criticism of President Trump's performance by Jim Mattis was, as revealed in that letter of resignation. So again, I think we're all going to have to watch in anticipation of what happens when the new Democratic majority takes over in the House of Representatives as of tomorrow is Thursday, right? They are sworn in tomorrow at noon. I also wanted to go back to an issue that we closed yesterday's program on. If you remember, I presented an article that I made a hard copy of, on the origins of the game of Monopoly. And we spent about the last 20 minutes of yesterday's program on this particular article. And when we began, when the article was first introduced, I remember making the point that we only had less than 20 minutes left in the program, so it was likely not going to be possible for us to take the article to its logical extremes. In other words, we wouldn't be able to give it the attention that I think the article warrants. And so therefore, I had basically said that, you know, if we didn't complete coverage of this issue yesterday, then we would pick it up again today. So again, if you go online, it is an article written, dated December 30th, by Kate Raworth, R-A-W-O-R-T-H. It is in a website called AEON, A-E-O-N. And the title of the article is How Monopoly Was Invented to Demonstrate the Evils of Capitalism. And the article identifies Elizabeth Magee, M-A-G-I-E, as the original inventor of the game of Monopoly. But it points out that Magee established two sets of rules for playing the game. Her goal, or her ultimate objective, was to create a board game which would enable people to see and understand the inequalities and the evils of capitalism that were suddenly at play in America in the late 19th century. Her idea for the board game came from reading Henry George's book, Progress and Poverty, which was written in 1879. Henry George was a critic of the private ownership of property. And he felt that property distribution was becoming more and more equal in society as the few were controlling more property and the many had access to less and less, and that it was creating real social division within American society. And George's answer to that was to tax property and use the revenue from the taxes that property generated for redistribution throughout society. In other words, making it possible that the very successful, through their taxes, would share their success with fellow citizens. And Henry George's conclusion was that the result of this would be to close the gap, the increasing gap between rich and poor. It was based on her reading of that book that Elizabeth McGee developed the board game, which we now know as Monopoly. She called it the landlord's game. And she set up two sets of rules. One set of rules she called the monopolist set of rules is what we have today, where players get ahead by buying up property, collecting rent from all those who happen to land on that property. You put expensive hotels on your property, and that causes the value of the property to go up. And when other players in the game land on your property, they're paying higher and higher fees for rent. And ultimately, the game ends when you've got it all and nobody else has anything. That's the Monopoly game that we know today. But Elizabeth McGee had set up a second set of rules, which she called the prosperity set of rules. And in that particular approach to the game, every player gained whenever someone acquired new property. It was based on Henry George's idea of taxing the value of land. And ultimately, the game ended when the person who began with the least amount of money had doubled the amount that they had. In other words, the accumulation of property and the paying of taxes on that property would mean that with the success of individual property owners, everybody benefited from it, rather than everybody suffering because of it. Elizabeth McGee said that the purpose of these two sets of rules was so players could experience a practical demonstration of the present system of land grabbing with all its usual outcomes and consequences, and thereby understand how different approaches to property ownership can lead to vastly different social outcomes. She said, it might have been called the game of life, for it contains all the elements of success and failure we see in the real world. And the object is the same as the human race in general seems to have, the accumulation of wealth. And then this particular article points out that the game, which ultimately would be called Monopoly, was purchased by Parker Brothers. And immediately Parker Brothers bought up Elizabeth Maggie's patent. And they released it by changing the name to Monopoly. But that was the only one set of rules that went out with the game. In other words, the decision was made by Parker Brothers that the value of the board game would be realized only with one of the two sets of rules that the original inventor, Elizabeth McGee, had established for the game. And thus, we have the game that we know now. Parker Brothers did not mention that Elizabeth McGee was the original inventor of the game. Rather, they attributed the creation of Monopoly to a gentleman named Charles Darrow, who had originally played the game and sold it to Parker's Brothers as if it was his own. And they used Darrow's success, becoming an overnight millionaire with the sale, as the kind of rags-to-riches story that drove public interest in the game of Monopoly. I thought, first of all, I didn't know that background. And so I found the information, the article itself, very interesting. And that's pretty much about as far as we got yesterday, in yesterday's program. What I wanted to suggest, however, was that there's an increasing likelihood or possibility that this particular story has meaning well beyond the game of Monopoly itself. In other words, what Parker Brothers did once it bought the rights to the game and changed the name to Monopoly, I think is very revealing. Because in effect, what the game of Monopoly does is promote the benefits, the competitive nature of capitalism, and introduces that to young people. In other words, a corporate decision was made to present the game in a way which would support corporate capitalism, which would support or worship, if you will, the idea of rags-to-riches opportunity in this system, but at the same time would not include the set of rules which pointed out the negatives of this competition and the fact that there were other ways of looking at the issue of property ownership and the idea that the property ownership could be taxed in such a way that the entire society would gain benefits from it. Everybody would win, in other words. Monopoly proposes a game in which only one person wins and everybody else loses. And that's pretty hardcore stuff. Obviously, Parker Brothers made the decision to emphasize or to promote that particular aspect of the game. And as we know, we know how popular the game has become. We know how popular Monopoly still is among young people. What struck me about this is that it kind of speaks to a pattern. We've addressed it here before on the Virtual Center several times. I can remember, well over a year ago, about 2 years ago, actually, about the issue of history. And I had put together in fact, I delivered this as a paper a couple of years ago, and then I presented it on this program. And what I had suggested is that we tend to get the history that we're looking for, the history we find is the story we're looking for when we first begin the search. That in essence, what we find is that history throughout the years has been skewed. We tend to get the history in our textbooks that those with the power to edit them want us to have. We aren't getting the past. We aren't getting access to the past with the idea that we look at the evidence and draw the appropriate conclusions that the evidence provide for us. But instead, we're getting a cherry-picked view of the past, which means that we're only being exposed to evidence that leads to a particular outcome that those with influence want us to have. We looked at that when we were looking at the founders. We looked at it in the person specifically of James Madison and Thomas Jefferson. We talked, Jefferson first, we talked about Jefferson's support of the idea of what he called the moral sense. The influence on Jefferson of the Scottish Enlightenment school of philosophy. The idea that there is within man a moral sense, what we call today the idea of conscience. The idea that man knows innately right from wrong. He doesn't have to be taught what's right and what's wrong. He innately knows it. And Jefferson made that famous statement in his letter, in a letter to his nephew, in which he said the Creator would be guilty of a major error, major faux pas, if the Creator intended man for society, in other words, intended man to be a social animal, able to get along and coexist with other human beings, and at the same time didn't give man the ability to make that work. To Jefferson, the idea of the moral sense was logical. It made perfect sense. It spoke to the validity of a divine plan. If you want your creation, human being, man, to be able to live together and get along with other men, then you've got to make sure that man has the ability to do that. And that's the moral sense, knowing right from wrong, knowing what behavior is acceptable and what behavior is not acceptable. And it's the existence of this so-called moral sense that makes it possible for people to live together in an organized society and set up rules that everybody agrees to abide by. To Jefferson, this just made common sense. And what we see is that in James Madison, we see in his letters and his papers, many of the Federalist papers we looked at, validate this idea of the moral sense. Madison believes that man isn't totally greedy, isn't totally self-interested. In fact, Madison says in one of the Federalist Papers, if man's nature was as evil as many of us say it is, then popular government could not happen. We could not have a republican form of government. The only way that this republican can work is if we have faith in man's ability to do what's right, to do the right thing, and not always be susceptible to greed and self-interest. On the other hand, in Federalist Number 10, Madison lays out a scheme where he describes or defines man's nature as being driven principally by self-interest. In Federalist Number 51, Madison made the statement that if men were angels, we wouldn't need governments at all. If we could rely on the fact that man naturally always did what was right rather than what was wrong, then we wouldn't need government, we wouldn't need laws, we wouldn't need rules, we wouldn't need police and military to enforce the rules. But on the other hand, Madison says in others of the Federalist Papers, but you can't take this idea of self-interest and make it exclusive. Because, as I mentioned just a moment ago, Madison believed that if man was totally driven by self-interest and could not do what was right, in other words, if man didn't have something within him that was more noble and more positive, then popular government could not work. So Madison puts his faith in man's ability to be taught and to learn the benefits and the advantages of doing the right thing. And that becomes a much more cosmopolitan picture of Madison. But on the other hand, the James Madison that our textbooks define for us or give us is the James Madison of Federalist Number 10. The idea that factions, self-interest, is sown into the nature of man. The fact that man will always be driven by his own self-interest. And if you put a premium on man's freedom, then what you are looking toward is the logical connection between man's freedom and his self-interest. And that means factions. Man's intelligence, man's mind, is going to tell him that he has a better chance of satisfying his self-interest if he unites with others who have the same interest and form a faction, because there are power in numbers. There is power in numbers. So the fact of the matter is, there are really two different James Madisons. The one that the textbook gives us and the James Madison we learn about when we read in the other Federalist Papers. And what we begin to realize is that we have been given or exposed to a James Madison that's not totally accurate. History has done us a disservice. Our textbooks are putting forth a James Madison that they want us to believe in. This is no different than what Parker Brothers did with Monopoly. It's essentially the same thing. Yet another example. This goes back a few years as well. Do you remember when we talked some time ago about the emergence, the origins of these federal agencies we refer to as Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac? These are government sponsored agencies principally devoted to making sure that vast numbers of citizens are able to purchase their own home in this society by making low-interest loans available for home purchasing. Fannie Mae was begun in the late 1930s during Roosevelt's New Deal. It was a federal agency. It was a federal program designed to free up capital so that American citizens could afford to buy their own home. This was Roosevelt's plan to counter the Great Depression and to make sure that the millions of people who lost their homes as a result of the Great Depression would never have to experience anything like that again. That the government would involve itself to such a degree that it would make sure that low-interest mortgages were available to everybody who had the wherewithal to own their own home. And that was the role that Fannie Mae played in helping the nation recover from the Great Depression. After World War II, it's not until 1970 that a similar agency is created called Freddie Mac. And it gets into the same business. The difference is that Freddie Mac, and eventually Fannie Mae as well, are no longer exclusively federal government programs. They are federally government-sponsored programs that are run by the private sector. In other words, the original intent of Fannie Mae, which is to make sure that large numbers of American citizens can own their own home, has been subtly changed by the time we get to 1970s. And the mortgage business becomes a business which is lucrative for private investors. The profit motive takes over the housing industry. And now Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae both are privately run, profit-driven operations based on the availability of capital for low-interest mortgages subsidized by the federal government. In other words, just as Parker Brothers eliminated one set of rules for the game of Monopoly in favor of the other one, so Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac undergo a significant change from being driven by the desire to make sure that American citizens can own their own homes, to a profit-driven industry designed principally to benefit investors. It's the profit motive which takes over the social objectives of the initial program. It's the same kind of thing. It's the same kind of thing as giving us a James Madison or a Thomas Jefferson whose views are more consistent with the world we live in. And therefore, we are being denied access to all the relevant information that makes these founders worthy of study. Instead of learning from them, we are being introduced to a particular version of them, which is the politically acceptable version. James Madison advocates an approach to government designed to promote free enterprise capitalism. In order to do that, you've got to eliminate the James Madison that talks about morality, that talks about the idea of the moral sense, that talks about the innate goodness which resides in every human being. Consequently, likewise, you have to get rid of the Thomas Jefferson, who believes in the moral sense, who argues that it only makes sense that the Creator would give man the innate abilities he needed in order to form a community. In our society, the community we're talking about is a community of self-interested, driven individuals. And we put a premium on individual freedom, not on community involvement. This is not an accident. I think that this particular history of monopoly speaks to a phenomenon that has become very, very significant in American society, and we see it in our history textbooks. We see it in government's approach to managing society. We've seen it in the desire among many people today, primarily conservative Republicans, to privatize Social Security, to privatize Medicare, to reduce the expenses of Medicare and Medicaid, to reduce people's ability to rely on the so-called social net, and to create a society in which people are responsible for making their own way and are not eligible for what these people refer to as entitlements. We see it in the debate over health care. The debate over whether health care ought to be a right or a commodity that everybody is not entitled to, but rather something that everybody must earn. We see it in attitudes towards the Affordable Care Act. We've seen it in statements and speeches delivered by people like Mitch McConnell and Paul Ryan and many others, who basically argue that health care is not something that ought to be given to everybody. Health care is something that you earn. And the idea is those people who can afford it deserve the best health care system in the world. But you can't have the best healthcare system in the world if you're going to make everybody eligible for it. So we begin to see this idea of manipulating the past or manipulating evidence in order to support the story that we most want people to buy into. I see that. In fact, I've mentioned that I'm playing around with the idea of doing a book on this particular issue related to the founders, by emphasizing the founders who were really there, as opposed to the definition of the founders that our textbooks tell us were there. That in effect, we've only been exposed to selected excerpts from Jefferson and Madison and John Adams and the others. And that where we can really learn from these founders is when we are exposed to their minds working on some of these more complicated, complex issues. The interaction, if you will, later in their life between Jefferson and John Adams, which we talked about some weeks ago, and how they kind of resolved some of the most complicated issues that exist. All of us can learn from their experience, but only if we're given access to their experience, not just to a portion of it. In one case, you're talking about education. In the other case, you're talking about indoctrination. I think the difference is significant. I think it exists in every society. When you study autocratic societies, you begin to see how autocratic governments, manipulate the media, manipulate the news, in order to make sure that people get only what's acceptable, not the unacceptable. That, I think, is what we're talking about. That's why I think this article on the game of Monopoly is so insightful and so important. I think it tells us an awful lot. We've reached the top of the hour, the end of our first hour. In fact, we've gone a little bit beyond it. It's 1 minute beyond the hour. So we're going to pause and take a 5-minute break. And I know that Agnes has queued up some music. And then when we come back, we'll be into yet another totally different topic. You're listening to the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. Please stay with us while we take a 5-minute break. We'll be right back, and we look forward to being with you then. Thank you.
We now return to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. Here's your host, Dr. Bill O'Brien.
Well, thank you, Agnes, and welcome to this, our second hour, on the second day of the new year. It's January 2nd in the year 2019. If you were just joining us, Thank you for your continued faith in us. And if you've been with us through the entire program so far, we thank you for staying with us through our break at the top of the hour. We look forward to hearing from you. We look forward to we have a number of different ways that you can interact with us. The most direct, obvious way is to get on the air and join us. And you can do that by calling into the Head On Radio Network studios. We have two lines available that will permit you to do that. Both of them have the same area code 304. The first number is area code 304-574-8178. The second number is area code 304-640-2829. If you're a little bit reluctant to call in, but at the same time you've got a point or an issue that you'd like to raise with me directly, then by all means, I would welcome an email from you or perhaps a comment on our Facebook page. If you'd like to send me an email, you can do that by sending it to the following address, W.A. O'Brien 906 at gmail.com. That's W.A. O'Brien, O-B-R-I-E-N, 906 at gmail.com. Or if you'd like to use our Facebook page, just go to the Virtual Center homepage on Facebook. Just go to facebook.com, and in the search box at the top of the homepage, type in the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution. You'll be onto our Facebook page, and you'll see a number of postings on that page, each of them followed by two links, a share link and a comment link. If you click on the comment link, it immediately gives you an opportunity to make a direct comment to me. Presumably, it would be about that posting, but it doesn't have to be. It can be about anything related to our program here at the Virtual Center. And obviously, if you click on the share link, we thank you for that as well, because that would take that particular posting and distribute it amongst all the people on all your friends on Facebook. So that would widen our coverage, widen our exposure, and obviously we would appreciate you if you did that. The point is, however you choose to interact with us, we want to make sure that you have the opportunity to do so. And so with that, I'd like to get into our second hour in today's program. I just picked up my notes on the issue of Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac that we just dealt with at the end of the last hour. And as I was looking this over during the break, I thought to myself, maybe it would be better if I shared this with you. I picked this up online, and it's just a history of Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae, what brought them into existence and how they changed, etc. And let me share with you exactly what this says. Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac are America's two largest mortgage companies, together holding or guaranteeing some $5 trillion in debt. Their names are semi-acronyms for their original government monikers. The Federal National Mortgage Association, that's Fannie, and the Federal Home Loan Mortgage Corporation, which is Freddie. During the Great Depression, as borrowers defaulted on mortgages en masse and banks found themselves strapped for cash, President Franklin D. Roosevelt and Congress created Fannie Mae in 1938 in order to buy mortgages from lenders, freeing up capital that could go to other borrowers. Although Fannie Mae began with just $1 billion in purchasing power, the agency helped usher in a whole new generation of American home ownership, paving the way for banks to loan money to low and middle income buyers who otherwise might not have been considered credit worthy. The idea being that the banks issue your mortgage loan, but these federal agencies reimburse the banks for the money loaned you. So in other words, it makes that money available to others as well. Fannie Mae grew so large over the years that in 1968, with the pressures of the Vietnam War straining the national budget, President Lyndon Johnson took Fannie Mae's debt portfolio off the government balance sheet. In other words, the government was strapped for cash during Johnson's administration because of the expenses of the Vietnam War. Many of you remember the debate over butter and bullets, if you remember, and whether you could have both. So in order to make more cash available for government, Johnson took Fannie Mae off the government balance sheet. It was converted into a publicly traded company owned by investors. 2 years later, Freddie Mac was launched, primarily to keep Fannie Mae from functioning as a monopoly. It went public in 1989. So Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac are programs that began, are government programs that began as a way to make low interest loans for homes, for housing, affordable to middle and lower income Americans. But later on, they were privatized and they became sources for investment opportunity. And therefore, home ownership ceased to be the principal objective of these programs and instead became a secondary objective. The primary objective became profit opportunities for investors. The idea being that as long as government stayed involved with these two agencies, it would continue to serve a public purpose. But a number of criticisms since then have argued that government involvement in Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae make it difficult for new players to get into the game. And so there has been pressure periodically to further privatize Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae. But again, my purpose in the first hour was to make it a point that this is yet another example of manipulating resources in such a way that you're promoting a particular approach. And I hope that we were able to do that. We used it in the Monopoly, the history of the game of Monopoly. We looked at it in Madison and Jefferson and the rest. And the theme, of course, is that the history we get from our textbooks is the history we're programmed to look for. And so somebody is doing the editing for us. Somebody is taking out the issues that don't pertain to a particular objective and leaving in there those issues or those factors that do promote that particular approach. So in a sense, history is being cherry-picked. I don't want today to end without making reference back to the program that Kevin Shanley did with us 2 weeks ago on China. I've received a number of comments about that particular program. And of course, it's available on archive. If you go to WhiteRoseSociety.org. Just go to that date, which is 2 weeks ago today, a Wednesday. And it was the Wednesday before Christmas. So it's, I can't remember the day offhand now. It was the 19th of December. So if you go to WhiteRoseSociety.org and go to our previous programs, just look for the program of December 19th. And that will be the program presented for the most part by Kevin Chanley. And if you remember, if you were with us during that program, Chanley spent the entire 2 hours talking about America's relationship historically, principally with China, but with other Asian countries as well. He talked about the international scene. He talked about perspective. He talked about the attitude with which this country has dealt with China and other Asian countries. And it talked about the fact that if you go back far enough in history, you find that the quality of civilization in Chinese history was so far superior to the West's for a long time that a lot of that is ignored. And obviously, Kevin talked quite a bit about the rivalry today between China and the United States as two dominant powers in the world, and what President Trump's pulling out of organizations like the Trans-Pacific Partnership and others are costing us. The TTP, for example, was an organization of 11 nations, primarily including the United States, but the rest of them mostly Asian nations, which did not include China. And its intent was to bring all of these nations together so that together they could provide some sort of counter to the power and the influence of the huge growing Chinese economy. President Trump's decision to leave that organization and President Trump's emphasis on America first and his determination to force China to play the international rules the way they were written is raising some serious issues. I think you've been watching over the last couple of weeks as the stock market has plunged. It opened today. I don't believe it's this low now, but today it opened down 300 points, the Dow. I think it's made somewhat of a comeback since then. I'm not really sure. But I was struck this morning. There's a story in the major newspapers about a speech that Chinese President Xi delivered at the Great Hall in Beijing for New Year's. And in that speech, he took on the issue of an independent Taiwan. China has always considered Taiwan as being part of China. And if you go back in history to Mao Zedong's takeover of China in the late 40s, and Mao Zedong's successful overthrow of the nationalist government in China, at that time under the leadership of Chiang Kai-shek. And Chiang and his followers were forced to abandon China and relocate to Taiwan. That political party was the so-called Kuomintang. The Kuomintang has become powerful again in Taiwan and currently advocates closer relationships with China. President Xi considers Taiwan still a part of mainland China. And in the speech, the New Year's speech that he delivered to Chinese military officers and guests in the Great Hall of the People in Beijing, President Xi talked about the fact that China still considers Taiwan to be part of China and still looks to unification as the ultimate goal of any talks that would take place between the two. This is an article that I took from the New York Times. China's president, Xi Jinping, warned Taiwan that unification must be the ultimate goal of any talks over its future, and that efforts to assert full independence could be met by armed force. Laying out an unyielding position on Wednesday in his first major speech about the contested island democracy. This speech is delivered one day after Taiwan's president, Xi Jinping, urged China to peacefully settle disputes over the island of Taiwan, where 23 million people, she said, want to preserve self-rule. So the issue is unification versus Taiwanese independence, and how other nations interact with and deal with Taiwan. I've got a couple of quotes from the speech that I wanted to share with you. This is from Xi's speech. The country is growing strong, the nation is rejuvenating, and unification between the two sides of the strait is the great trend of history, Xi said. He talked about unifying it, one country, even though the two systems, he promised, would remain separate. Xi said different systems are not an obstacle to unification. Even less are they an excuse for separation. The private property, religious beliefs, and legitimate rights and interests of Taiwanese compatriots will be fully assured, Xi said in a speech. Obviously, the Taiwanese do not accept that. Xi said, we make no promise to abandon the use of force, and we retain the option of taking all necessary measures. Those options, he said, could be used against intervention by external forces. And that opens up the question of the United States and the trade war that currently exists between the Trump administration and China. On the last day of 2018, Monday, the 31st of December, President Trump signed into law the Asia Reassurance Initiative Act, which is intended to counter China's growing military influence. The section of that law that relates to Taiwan speaks to America's continued commitment, quote, to counter efforts to change the status quo and to support peaceful resolution acceptable to both sides of the Taiwan Strait. It also calls on the American president to send high-level officials to Taiwan and regularly sell arms to the island. The reason I mention this is because it fits so well into the presentation that Kevin Shanley gave us a couple of weeks ago here in the Virtual Center. And it speaks to the relevance of this particular issue. China is still talking about reunification between mainland China and the island of Taiwan and the 23 million people who reside there. And President Xi has raised the specter of military force as a potential way to bring about that unification. At the same time, President Trump is signing legislation committing to an independent Taiwan and confirming our determination to continue to sell arms to an independent Taiwan and to do anything we need to do in order to support Taiwan's continued separation from mainland China. This particular article in the New York Times points out that the United States sent warships to the Taiwan Strait three times last year in order to show its support for Taiwan. That was done under the leadership of Defense Secretary Jim Mattis, who's now gone. There's no question that President Xi's speech raised the issue of military force as a last resort, not a first one. But the fact of the matter is, this is an extremely volatile situation. Therefore, the presentation that Kevin Shanley gave to us is significant information that all of us need in order to understand the full context of this particular issue, because this issue could explode, it seemingly, at almost any time. We're in a very dangerous, very sensitive situation in the Far East right now. It seems a little bit more frightening given the changes underway in the Trump administration, given some of the things that are happening in the White House, the replacement of John Kelly and Jim Mattis, for example, and their replacement with people who are envisioned to be much closer and more in tune with President Trump. What is all of this going to mean in terms of how we behave in this very, very sensitive situation in the Far East? I might say that I was chatting on the phone with Kevin Shanley New Year's Day, which called him to wish him a Happy New Year. We chatted for about a half an hour, I guess. Kevin looks forward to coming back and joining us again on another program, and I told him we would do that in the future. I'd like to kind of, you know, don't like to do them too quickly, one on top of the other. But I'm thinking in a few weeks or so, I think it would be more than appropriate to invite Kevin to come back and do another program with us on China. There's so many things, even though we devoted the better part of 2 hours to Kevin's theme, the fact of the matter is there's so much we didn't touch upon. The issue of Chinese demands for access to our technology in order for American corporations to do business in China, we basically had to make our latest technology available to the Chinese. And the result is that China is making leaps into world leadership, which are, many people believe, threatening, if not frightening. So, again, this is yet another issue that it seems to me bears watching. I don't have anything formal to present on this, but I did want to make an observation. In reading the national media, reading, you know, as I do, every day I scan the New York Times, the Washington Post, the Washington Times, Boston Globe, L.A. Times. Looking at op-eds and trying to get a feel for the issues that are out there. One of the things I noticed today, and this is a little bit frightening, is a very negative sense. I think we're seeing it in the stock market continuing to go down. I think we're seeing evidence of fear and insecurity and concern reflected not only in the stock market, but reflected in changes happening in the White House. People are unsure what's going to happen. They're not secure about the future. As we enter 2019, we do so with a pronounced sense of trepidation and insecurity. People just aren't sure. They aren't comfortable with what's going on. There are too many things going on in the world and in the country itself that don't give people a sense of confidence and security. Once again, the data from the end of 2018 tells us, for the third year in a row, life expectancy in the United States went down. The suicide rate continues to go up. The opioid epidemic seems to be getting worse rather than better. President Trump is warning us in so many different ways about the threats to our security, the threats to our border. He made the decision unilaterally to pull troops from Syria and to pull back half of our military force from Afghanistan. This against the advice of those military minds in his administration who are now gone. Jim Mattis and John Kelly. McMaster left some months ago. So when you read the papers day after day, you begin to get a sense of insecurity and concern, fear of the unknown, maybe. I'm seeing it reflected in op-ed pieces. Let me share two of these with you just quickly. In today's New York Times, Paul Krugman wrote on the Trump tax cut and says that it's even worse than you've heard. He's talking about the dangers and the unfairness of the Trump tax cut. And he said the story that we've been getting about the tax cut is too generous, too kind. This, Krugman said, is the story most of us read about. Quote, the tax cut has caused corporations to bring some money home, but they've used it for stock buybacks rather than to raise wages. And the boost to growth has been only modest. Krugman said, that's the coverage we've been getting. The tax cut did bring back money from overseas. It caused corporations to bring some money back home. But the problem is that corporations are using it to buy back their own stock, rewarding their investors, not putting it into the creation of more jobs. Krugman says, that doesn't sound great, but the fact is it's better than the reality. Because, as Krugman said, no money, in fact, has been brought home. The tax cut has probably reduced national income. At least 90% of Americans will end up poorer thanks to that tax cut. And then he addresses each of these issues. He points out that for people to say that U.S. corporations have brought money home, what they're referring to are dividends that overseas subsidiaries have paid to the parent corporations here in the States. He points out that for the most part, this is merely bookkeeping for tax purposes. No money has actually moved. So in fact, the argument that corporations brought tens of millions of dollars back into this country is not true. Krugman says the tax cut induced some accounting maneuvers, but did nothing to promote capital flows to America. Then Krugman points out that in fact the tax cut did exactly the opposite. Rather than bring money into the country, it drove money out of the country. And I don't think I appreciated this. I found this particularly telling. The tax cut obviously is a big break for corporations. But the fact of the matter is, it benefits significant numbers of foreigners. Because a lot of the country's corporate wealth is owned by foreigners, either directly because corporations have their own foreign subsidiaries, or indirectly because foreigners own American stocks. And then Krugman points out something that I didn't know. Roughly a third of U.S. corporate profits flow to foreign nationals, which means that a third of the tax cut flowed abroad rather than staying at home. So in effect, the result of the tax cut, Krugman says, is exactly opposite to what we were told was happening. We were told that the tax cut, the lower tax rates for corporations, would cause corporations to bring capital back into the country, and that would regenerate and make the economy grow even faster. But the fact of the matter is that really isn't happening. And rather, what has happened is some tax accounting manipulation, which really didn't move money at all. But when you combine that with the fact that a third of corporate stock is owned by foreign investors, that means that when corporations buy back their own stock, money is going overseas. Consequently, the economic growth that was supposed to happen as a result of the tax cut, growth that was going to enable the tax cut to pay for itself, has never materialized. The result is that the deficit has already increased by more than $1 trillion because of the tax cut. And it's anticipated that that trillion will become $1.5 trillion by the time the fiscal year is out. And now leaders in Congress, Republican leaders in Congress, are beginning to talk about strategies government must take in order to make up for the shortfall from the tax cut. And what they're talking about is going after Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. In other words, the people are going to pay for this tax cut to corporations. That's Krugman's first article of the new year. And if you go down the page a little bit, you come across David Brooks's first article of the new year. And he talks about 2019 being the year of the wolves. His article is about partisanship, the tribal distinctions between the two major parties, the fact that the two major parties have become such bitter rivals that each sees the other as a threat to the nation. Republicans feel comfortable labeling Democrats as threats to the nation, danger to the security of the nations. The fact that Republicans are true patriots and Democrats are not. And you get the same kind of arguments coming from the other side. And David Brooks's theme is raising the question whether 2019 is going to demonstrate a constitutional system able to withstand the tribalism of expanded partisanship in our politics, or whether it's not. And he's not very positive. So what you get, if you think of, just take these two articles together and think about them. Krugman telling us that the tax cut is actually worse than we're being told. Brooks telling us that the shape of our politics is much worse than any of us have suspected. And raising the question as to whether our constitutional system is even going to be able to handle the degree of partisanship and tribalism that has overtaken our political landscape. And then you look at the Dow continuing to go down rapidly. As I mentioned at the opening bell at 9:30 this morning, the Dow was down an additional 300 points. In the next hour, it started to make a comeback, and I never went back to check it again. So I don't really know where it is now.
Bill?
Yes.
I have
yes.
a question, because you were talking about monopoly, and then we started talking about the tax cuts. So basically, this is a hostile takeover?
In what way? Can you be more specific?
I started thinking about some of the discussions that we've had, and a hostile takeover allows a bidder to take over a target company whose management's unwilling to agree
right.
to a merger.
Right.
So Trump is a businessman, and
right.
I say that, you know, kind of shakily, but so he has the GOP behind them and a coordinated effect to do a hostile takeover of the United States because it's
saying.
Our business.
Yeah. Right. In other words, if you adopt that business model and look at it from that perspective.
Yeah, and the light just went on.
I hadn't thought of this, but, you know, you're right. Because the tribalism that exists in our politics is an example of – it's the kind of language that you would associate with hostile takeover, wouldn't you?
Yeah, and I mean – what you were hitting on there, it just kind of lit me up, and I thought, you know, we're in the middle of a hostile takeover.
Yeah, I see what you, I see what you're saying. And that the irony is that's what David Brooks is laying out. He doesn't say it in those terms, but that's what he's talking about. In other words, he is not sure that we can withstand this.
Well, if one third of the tax cut is going to foreign investors, then basically we're being walled off,
right,
isolated, safety nets taken
away.
Our money is
leaving the country.
How many 401?
When in fact we were told that money was going to be coming back to the country.
Exactly. And how many 401ks have gone south over this?
Right.
So think about it in that way. What would the Constitution do to help us?
That's what bothers me, is I'm really not concerned that our Constitution has been challenged
enough,
as it's being challenged now before, except at the time of the Civil War. And I'll mention this now because it fits. I was going to mention it later, but there's a couple of volumes that have come out recently, the publication of John Quincy Adams's diaries. And there's an extensive review of these two volumes in the latest New York Review of Books. And it's really interesting because it addresses the career of John Quincy Adams. And that's why I wanted to share a few things about that today before we went off the air. But one of the things that is suggested is, you know, comes out of these diaries, is that John Quincy Adams predicted 40 years before the Civil War, he predicted the issue of slavery would permanently divide the nation. In other words, the constitutional system of this nation could not withstand the threat of slavery. And you could see it in the founders, which is the reason that the founders were more than willing to make compromises with the South at the very beginning. And Adams predicted that these compromises were only temporary and short term, that eventually the nation would split and have to be reconstructed. I mean, he basically anticipated history in these diaries. And he kept – I couldn't believe it, the extent of his diaries. But one of the things that's interesting is that when John Quincy Adams was serving in Congress, in the House of Representatives, he was receiving petitions from citizens – and asked to introduce these petitions in Congress, many of them, most of them, dealing with slavery. One of the petitions proposed the construction of a wall between the North and the South to separate the slavery from the free labor system. And the argument was that was the only way to preserve the nation, was to separate the two sections, similar to what China did when they built the Great Wall of China. And here we are today with Donald Trump talking about a wall on our southern border.
It never pays to be Cassandra.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable. You know, one of the other things I heard today, which is interesting, I don't think I realized this. There are more illegals entering the nation from Canada than there are from Mexico. That in effect, and so the implication, of course, is that we don't see a threat from the border with Canada, because most of the people that come into the country from Canada are like us.
Exactly.
But and so now you get back to the race issue again. Wow. Unbelievable. But this idea of hostile takeover, from the business perspective, I see exactly where you're coming from.
Well, if the money –
this is the way that Donald Trump would look at it.
Well, if the money's flowing out and – we've had a lot of interaction with Russia. A lot of our government has had interaction with Russia this year and was open about it. And there wasn't a problem. But if there's more money going out than coming in,
right,
and we're isolated, we're walled
right
off, Think about that.
Yeah.
And if you break the people that are underneath of you, because if all the safety nets go away and they do privatize Social Security, then we're at a loss.
You know, the New York Times which I think is really interesting, is beginning to focus on the fact that this is the year 2019, and it's going back a full century to 1919, right at the end of World War I. And the New York Times is going to begin to run a series of articles on the extent to which events and issues in 1919 accurately projected what the country would be going through a century later, what we're going through now. And it's fascinating. But it dealt the article that's in the first edition of this series is on the year 1919, and it talks about Woodrow Wilson going to Versailles and these people sitting down to redraw the map of the world in order to make sure that another world war like World War I would not happen again. And the idea that World War I was caused principally by excessive nationalism. And that's exactly what President Trump is taking us in that direction now. With you know, we're becoming less and less international and more focused on America first. And the same things are happening in Hungary and in Turkey and in the Philippines and in Brazil. And, you know, and less and less internationalism, more and more of this nationalism which produced World War I. So it's kind of frightening, because the world plan that Wilson and the others brought to Versailles was a plan to try to create a world that would make that impossible again. And we've effectively abandoned all of it.
Well, I just want to take a moment to thank you.
Because thank you.
This isn't a perspective that I've found anywhere else, and no, I look a lot.
Well, I'll tell you, it's a little bit frightening, and I'm beginning to see it in so many places. There are a lot of people out there in a variety of different fields who are frightened, who are uncertain about the future.
Well, I know the medical aspect of it's really shaken up for this coming year.
Oh, it's just amazing that we've got. It's not only citizens. I mean, you know, we hear a lot about the fact that this is the first generation where people are convinced that their children are not going to be better off than they were. Traditionally, it's been the other way around throughout our history until now. We're seeing that our life expectancy is declining. Our suicide rate is increasing. We're seeing citizens refusing to inoculate their children from diseases. We're seeing the rebirth of diseases that we thought were dead once. And it's very clear that people really don't know which way to go. They're not sure anymore.
Well, you know, right before a terrible event, animals will get skittish. They react. They feel it before humans do.
Right, right.
And that's what we're acting like, because we're animals too.
Yeah.
But I think we feel it, we just don't know how to react to it.
We don't know. We just don't have that sense of security that was always so important to us. People don't know where they're going to get a job. They don't know whether an investment in a college education is really worth it or not. They don't know what the future is going to bring. They're uncertain and insecure and afraid. And the irony is, when people feel like that, that's when you get Donald Trump's. You know, that's the classic example of the authoritarian personality syndrome. That when you're insecure and unsure and frightened, you look for a power figure. You look for somebody that can basically share with you, yes, you're right to be afraid. Look at this world. It's a terrible world out there, the president says.
And he's
it's
the one
mess.
Who's eliciting that feel.
It's a mess. And basically what he's implying is Only if you all stick together and support me can we deal with this.
Well, considering he's had three marriages, Bill, I mean, he's adept at doing this. This is gaslighting.
Well, I'll tell you.
No fault on the three marriages. It's just the way they kind of played out.
Yeah, I hear you. And each one of them began, each one of the affairs began before the previous marriage ended.
Pretty much. It's, you know, yeah. Dear penthouse, I never imagined it would turn out like this. So.
Yeah, yeah. Well, listen, I don't like to be the bearer of bad news, but when you look at some of this, when I read that David Brooks piece, I mean, he's usually one of the more one of the more positive people. He usually, you know, in fact, a lot of people, there's stories about people at some Ivy League schools and everything laughing at David Brooks because he tends to be so optimistic about the future and free enterprise and all these other things. But today's piece was not optimistic.
At some point, I mean, he won't be optimistic if they keep making fun of him.
He left the image today when he talked about the Year of the Wolves. He's going back to, you know, to a novel, to My Antonia, and going back to the story of the wolves and, you know, trying to escape and lightening the sled by throwing out newly married couple in order to be able to get away from the wolves.
Yeah, I started to say that book didn't end well.
No. And basically what you're talking about is when times are tough and people are afraid, they do horrible things to each other. And that may be the point at which we are right now as we go into 2019. At least that's the message I got from Brooks. And it's a little bit scary. And then when you read Krugman on the economy – And you listen to Kevin Chanley on our relations with China and how uninformed we are about China and the threat of China and all the rest of it. It's really frightening.
Well, I'd never heard that perspective before. Dr. Chanley was brilliant.
Yeah, he really knows this stuff. He just sent me today, by the way, an email. And it's a copy of an article that he just finished on the legal system in China, which I'm interested. I haven't had a chance to read it yet. But I'm really interested in it because I know the legal system in China, the tradition is much different. The argument was that the emperor was ultimately God's representative on earth. So as long as the emperor defined justice, then you had a justice system that could never be wrong. And, of course, our system of 12 jurors making the decision, there's always the issue that justice could not be, you know, may not prevail. And China never had that. So I'm interested to see what Kevin has said about the legal system in China. But anyway, God, look at the time. Agnes, we're gone. It's 58 after already.
It flew by.
I'm telling you, we got less than 2 minutes to go.
Thank you, Bill.
I'm going to have to.
I'll let you finish up.
Okay, thank you, Agnes. And I'm going to hold off on John Quincy Adams, but I'm going to bring him to. I got to tell you, and we only got a minute left, but let me just share this with you. I think this is unbelievable. I never appreciated this, and I'm kind of guessing that you do. John Quincy Adams, who was born in 1767, held more high federal offices, not only than anyone in his family, but more than anyone in the history of this nation. Listen to this. He began his career as minister to the Netherlands in 1794 to 1797, to Prussia from 1797 to 1801. Then he was a senator, U.S. senator from Massachusetts, 1803 to 1808. Then President Madison appointed him as minister to Russia, 1809 to 1814. In 1811, Madison appointed him as an associate justice to the Supreme Court. The Senate approved him, confirmed him, but then he chose not to accept the appointment because he wanted to keep his ambassadorship to Russia. Then he became as Secretary of State under James Monroe. He authored the Monroe Doctrine. Then in 1824, he became President of the United States. Served one term. He was defeated in 1828 by Andrew Jackson. 3 years later, in 1831, he was elected in Massachusetts to go to Congress as a representative from the state of Massachusetts. He served there from 1831 until he died in 1848. His whole life was public service, and he held more different posts than anybody in history. I think that was fantastically interesting. But anyway, we are now at the end of our time. It is exactly 3 p.m. in the East. We have reached the top of the hour. Again, let me thank you for your continued support of the program. I hope you have a wonderful rest of today, Wednesday, and a wonderful week as well, and weekend. All things working out the way they are planned, will be back with you this coming Monday. Again, for Bob Kincaid and Agnes and the folks at Head On, thank you so very much for your continued support. We do appreciate it. We appreciate you very much. Thank you.